Since the dawn of civilization, the powerful have conspired to twist the course of history to suit their own designs. Like puppeteers, a few shadowy figures could still be pulling the strings of destiny for billions. Those who cry conspiracy are usually mocked at, for sometimes the truth is so obvious it goes unnoticed. Are those merely paranoid fantasies cooked up to feed the appetite of paperback readers and web surfers, but which bear no relation to reality? Or are we living out some perfectly executed plan? Wars, revolutions, social movements, terrorist attacks. Everything is given an official explanation. But perhaps nothing is what it seems to be. Let's dare to unveil the incredible world of secret societies.
Freemasonry, mother of all secret societies, perhaps the most suspected and persecuted organization of all time. And this in spite of the fact that there are few, very few people who truly know what it's all about. Is it really, as its critics say, the hidden power behind the most important world events? Or is it, as we can see today, a slightly decadent social club with childish rituals? How did this antique secret society that still boasts more than 6 million brethren get started? What are its real objectives? How has it influenced world events for more than 12 centuries? And more important still, how is it influencing them today? Freemasonry defines itself as an innocent fraternity whose primary objectives is to seek the welfare of humanity through the spiritual elevation of its members. But for its critics, it's just a gigantic pyramid of manipulators with the secret objective of world domination, with unwritten codes of silence and cooperation reminiscent of the mafia. So who's right?
A swift perusal of the history of Freemasonry brings to light certain disquieting characteristics. Its impenetrable secrecy, the severity of the penalties for those who break their oaths, the general public's ignorance of its true reach, influence, and real purposes, and most disturbing of all, its obvious participation in many of the key events that have changed the course of history over the last few centuries.
Secret rituals, obscure symbolism, mysterious objectives, qualities made an easy target mainly by its arch enemy, the Roman Catholic Church. And one wonders, are these real reasons to fear Freemasonry? Or is it all just a matter of groundless accusations, mere incomprehension and prejudice against Enlightenment? Why do the Freemasons still maintain such secrecy if they have nothing to hide? So how did it all begin?
The origins of Freemasonry go back to the 7th century, when it was founded as a guild of builders, bricklayers, and stonemasons, who tried to keep secret their technical knowledge in order to protect their livelihoods. These masons were not the construction workers we might picture today, but technical and artistic masters that could undertake the most prestigious constructions at a time when building technology was limited to a set square, a plumb line, and little else.
The original masons built cathedrals and castles that endured for centuries, surviving wars, earthquakes, time. To the common people of those times, such technical accomplishments endowed the masons with almost magical powers, powers that had to be kept secret to outsiders.
Thin columns that still hold graceful, ogival arches with narrow ribs, towers of hitherto unimaginable heights that scrape the heavens and inspire God-fearing veneration. Chambers with perfect acoustics and overhanging gargoyles to scare away evil spirits. Ratios of strength, beauty, and proportion that even today surprise engineers and mathematicians. The extraordinary knowledge and skills of these men constituted the best-kept secret of all time. The development of projects would take generations to complete, and the accompanying know-how was passed down from father to son, from teacher to apprentice. The full preparation of an apprentice took 7 years and began when he was only 12. After the first 3 years, there was an initiation ritual, and certain codes and symbols were revealed to him. Upon completing the 7th year, he would graduate as a fellow of the craft. Only years later would he qualify as a master mason.
Freemasonry soon acquired a spiritual and ideological dimension that clashed with the value system of its time. This made it the perfect organization to host ideas considered dangerous, ideas that needed to be kept secret at all costs.
This earliest manifestation of Masonry is known as Operative Masonry, since its members were active builders. Though the society was born in the Middle Ages, Masons were inspired by much older secret societies, some dating from pre-Christian times. Secret societies have existed since the dawn of civilization. They were formed in order to preserve and defend knowledge that afforded power, and to transmit and maintain ideas that offended the powers that be. Ideas whose free and open expression might have brought down a death sentence upon a person who simply dared to utter them. A good example is the Pythagoreans, who were organized like a secret society. Pythagoras was a philosopher who lived in Greece in the 6th century BC, and his discoveries had immense influence on Masonic thought. Centuries later, Pythagoras' theorem was of great importance to the operative Masons, as it allowed them, for example, to execute perfectly straight angles. Pythagoras was pursued and murdered by his enemies, but his knowledge persisted, and the set square became the emblematic symbol of Freemasonry that is still used to this day.
Operative Masons clearly despised what the clergy had become just a few centuries after the death of Christ. A decadent bunch of sinners too busy looking after their worldly possessions to take time to shepherd the souls of their flock. The same feelings were felt for the oppressing nobility who owned land and life. The irony was that the Masons, ideological antagonists to the persecutory dogmatism of Rome, had in the Catholic Church and in nobility their main client.
The old bas-reliefs and ornamentations of Europe's most famous cathedrals still bear witness to the sharp humour through which the Masons left evidence of their disagreement with and distrust of that omnipresent power. In the Church of St. Sebald in Nuremberg, there is a tomb showing a monk and a nun in a pretty compromising position. In the Cathedral of Würzburg, replicas are found of the famous Joachim and Boaz columns that stood at the entrance of King Solomon's temple. They are fundamental symbols of Masonry, together with Hiram Abiff, the mythological builder of King Solomon's temple, who was murdered because of his refusal to reveal the secret of his art. A genuine coded Masonic signature.
But the belief that Freemasonry is an atheistic movement solely because of its hatred of the Catholic Church is completely misguided. The Masons simply wanted to have the liberty to worship God in the way they chose, not in the way dictated to them by Rome.
To be accepted into the Brotherhood, every Mason must believe in a unique supreme being, no matter who it is. To accommodate for different beliefs, and in line with their origins as builders, Masons have come to call this being Gao, or Gautu, Great Architect of the Universe. Its symbol, the All-Seeing Eye, is inspired by the Egyptian Eye of Horus.